Welcome.
It's a lot of
Thank you.
We're supposed to...
Welcome, they're real, so dive in.
Would you like a cupcake or a...
Pass them round.
We'll pass them round after.
I didn't realise we were at Claridge's.
Thank you for being here.
Nothing's been laced with anything. It's all fine and safe.
Healthy.
You can trust us.
Yeah.
We'll eat it first.
We're your friends. We're not like the others. Yeah.
James, I'd like to start with you, if that's
please,
all right.
Please, yes.
Exactly.
You're intrigued by time, which is a big part and a big theme of this film as well.
Yes, yes.
The main theme of this film, I have to take away from it being a woman, is a strong female character that you've told so brilliantly in this
Thank
film.
Thank you.
Continue to tell as well.
Thank you. Well, yeah, I think it's a very important part of the Alice tradition, is that Alice is such a strong character. And And you know, I think Lewis Carroll wrote it like that, as like...
in disaster. Yep.
If you're very still, that will work.
That's
I saved four of them.
That's enough, that's all good. I think Lewis Carroll was very keen to make sure that everyone understood that Alice was kind of part of this new generation of women who were very different to their predecessors.
Yeah.
And weren't prepared to stand for the status quo for much longer. And that happened. Alice's generation is the generation that grew up to be suffragettes. So they changed the world in many ways. And I think Alice was part of that generation, so that's very important to me.
Sasha, your turn, sir.
Yes.
Time is, I find time is really quite complex character. You never quite know whether he's a good guy or the bad guy, whose side he's on. Not so good?
Saved a bit of money on the...
There you go. Put it in there.
Salmonella or...?
Put it in there.
It's going down.
Okay, it's going down, great. Yeah, you never quite know if, you know, whose side he's on, this good guy, bad guy sort of thing. But a lot of his story's told not just through the script, but his kind of physicality as well. Did you have fun kind of bringing that to life in a way? You know, from what was on the script?
I was very depressed at the time. This guy here was bullying me. There were some elastic bands thrown at me. He had a security team hound me.
Wow.
You know, pin me down. I was, I think the term is wedgied by a large man from Zambia.
Yeah, your pin down was...
I was pinned down.
It was a different
big
thing.
Man.
I was overwhelmed. It was...
Well, so was the person pinning me
Yeah.
The grinding.
But time is a character. He is kind
time
of
is a
he's
character.
Complex, which is
he
a
is,
great.
He is complex. Was that the character I was saying?
That was your character.
Right, right. I thought I was doing Hatter. No, time is what you want. Well, I managed to, you know, I wanted to wear tights in the movie because I have a sort of lady's legs. And that's not a gender-specific comment. Yeah, exactly. So, thank you. And so it was very important for me to wear have a kind of tighted character.
Okay.
And also, I sort of tried to create this character who was immature, incredibly narcissistic, and ill-suited for the most important job in the world. You know, so a bit like Donald Trump.
true and untrue. Oh, it was great to come back and explore this story of Alice and the Hatter.
That's not what you told me.
I actually did the movie on a dare. I did. Somebody wanted me to run a mile. I said, no. It turned into this thing. We fought. He knows karate. He came in, made a deal, and I did it.
Yeah, exactly. Overpowered, yeah.
But it shows a different, very different side of the Hatter, you know, that beyond the kind of, you know, multi-personality, you know, Hatter. It shows a Hatter that goes near to his lowest point.
Mia. Yeah.
Come on, that was fascinating.
Yeah.
You've got there.
If you had a close up, you'd have seen the tears.
Yeah.
It was great. It was I think doing the film again, everybody sort of knew a little bit more what to expect, and it was just yeah, it was really fun. I mean, and I think James pushed everybody in a kind of emotional way, and then also sort of brought his own humour to it, which was really great. And yeah, it was great.
Suzanne, that's such an important point, isn't it? The humour to it and the tone of the film as well, you know, this absolutely gorgeous script as well that Linda wrote. What was it about Linda's script that you kind of thought, you know, she nailed it in terms of where you wanted to take the film?
Well, we took a long time developing the script after the first movie had come out, and this notion of time, you know, this theme of time, which, you know, James and Sasha brought so much comedy to it, but there's also a lot of emotion to that idea in the film, you know, the preciousness of time and how any of us on any given day don't necessarily spend our time doing the things that are the most important to us, and when you watch the film, you'll probably take a second thought about how you spend the time in your day.
Tim, sir, hello at the end there. You're here as an exec producer on this film, but very much agreed with James being the choice for a director for this. Why was he the right man for this job?
Well,
pretend you're not here for a second.
He wanted to do it. That's primarily
thing.
But also, he just had an enthusiasm, and I just, you know, he just had a take on it that I just felt really, really, positive about, and it, you know, he just, for me, it was kind of a fluke, the first one anyway, so the idea that he had such a positive and clear idea about it, I just thought, well, yeah, it needs a different energy, and anything I can do to support that, again, because these are big things, and it needs somebody that has that energy and focus and idea about it to pull it off.
Did you have any problem with green screen after the...
I'm still seeing green. I mean, in fact, I kicked a few people out of here wearing green shirts earlier. But,
Johnny Depp, I was wondering, considering that this is the second time you play Mad Hatter, what stayed on you this time? And now you're starting giving concerts with all the vampires. I was wondering what's happening when you're on stage. It's the real Johnny Depp, or also a character?
All the questions.
What was the question? the real Johnny Depp, you mean on stage, playing music? Well, music was my first love, you know, at the age of 12, and I haven't stopped playing since. It's still my first love. But there was a certain point when I reached, that area of your, what they call a career, where people start to know who you are from one particular field, and having have been a musician all my life, I knew that it was over. You know, that dream that I'd had since I was 12 was kind of just done. It was over with, and I was fine. I playing on people's records, friends' albums, and whatnot, and just keep a low profile. But then Alice, when we had him in, we had Alice in Dark Shadows, and he asked me to jam with him at the 100 Club, which is a real honor, you know, and played a few songs, and then he asked me if I felt like writing some songs with him, so I wrote about 5 or 6 songs, came to LA, and then suddenly it started, I thought I was writing songs for Alice Cooper, you know. And then suddenly it turned into this Hollywood vampires thing, and so that, in a weird way, that dream that I'd left behind, you know, kind of became a reality, in a sense that I didn't have to do all that ridiculous shit where, you know, you would, the front man. I'm not built for lead singer syndrome. I just get to play the guitar, stand in the dark, and it's a gas. So it's like movies become my day job, you know? And then doing this film again, coming back into the Hatter was a real treat, because you know you always feel, even though you know, I mean, I'm not a big movie watcher, you know, myself. You always feel like there's something more you could do. You always feel like, God damn, I should have put that there, or what, you know. And with coming back, we had the opportunity to do that, and I think make a more interesting performance. For, you know, or take from the Hatter.
Thank you.
Come on, that was excellent.
That was a great answer, yeah. Yeah, round of applause, go on. Lady over there.
Oh, I'm putting it out. I'm crying my eyes out each time.
What do you think a modern audience can take from it today, and what would you like young girls to take from the Alice character?
I just think it's really great how at the beginning of this film she's been travelling for the last 2 years and she's been so empowered and really knows who she is, and then she's quite disappointed when she comes back to England to see that expectations of her are so low, and just that she has this innate sense that she sort of deserves more than that, or you know, even just to be happy or to be able to do what she wants is really great. And just that angle, and also that we're sort of satirizing female hysteria, which was taken, you know, very seriously not that long ago. So just I think it's, you know, really wonderful that you know, we've come quite a long way, and there's still a long way to go, but it's really lovely that that'll be the first kind of contact for a lot of young girls and boys also.
I think there's something too about for women in their 20s that, in terms of what modern audiences can relate to, that Alice is at that point where she knows what she wants to do with her career and she's very focused on that, but then she also has to deal with her relationships at home and redefining her relationship with her mother, which happens with your parents in your 20s, or trying to figure out your own romantic relationships, or it's sort of a turning point, you know, for all young women at that age, and I think that modern audiences will absolutely relate to on Alice's journey.
Yeah, her mum says it best. Her mum says in the film, Alice can do whatever Alice chooses to do. And that, for women at that time, that's very unusual, because in Victorian England, you had to do what you were told, pretty much, if you were a girl. And that, I think, is what Alice teaches her mum in this movie. So it's a really nice message, and I think that's very important today, too.
Or sadly, there are some people today still trying to tell girls they have to do what they're
told. Well, yeah,
exactly. So we're still pushing back on that.
Oh, I know,
right?
Yeah. Not one yet.
Right.
Hello. Hi.
Great. I was. Wait, sorry, I was in character. I think I've got food poisoning. Feeling slightly.
Saw the film last night. I was fascinated by Time's accent. Is he and his seconds, are they German? Is that a compliment to German timekeeping, perhaps?
Or? Is he he's Germanic. He's more slightly.
Alison Wonderland.
Yeah. He lives, in Thingy Land. Yeah, but he's, Bavarian-y kind of,
For me, he's kind of Bavaria via California. That's why I like him. He's kind of mid-Atlantic.
You know, he has that kind of, overly pompous, very emphatic way of talking where everything seems very crucial, even though it can be complete nonsense.
I thought you'd base it on Jean-Claude Van Damme.
That was me.
That's the Hatter. That was me.
I based the Hatter on
two characters.
I'm Monica from London, by the way. Just to finish, I think the guy is Swiss. I thought he was Swiss, because Swiss
are you, are you telling me what my bloody character is? Yeah, well, I tell you what, I think you don't sound like you're from London.
We get to see the Mad Hatter as a little boy, very sweet and creative, with that creative flair. But he's still like a normal boy. But then we left wanting to know more about the Mad Hatter. Maybe, you know, what can you tell us about how did he get mad? And maybe, is there going to be a film about like a sort of prequel or standalone Mad Hatter film?
Well, Harvey Weinstein made him mad once. Disney made him mad a couple of times.
Something in the
made
back
him
story?
Mad. Well, actually, the thing with the Hatters back in the 19th century was that they're doing a beaver pelt top hat. The glue, all the glue that they used to put the pelt and all the to dress it up, it was rife with mercury, and so it ended up at that time. I mean, you know, that Hatters actually there was a thing. A lot hatters started going a little, you know, sideways. And they figured out it was the mercury. So that's, that. Hence the sort of the, you know, the orange and the green and the, you know, he just, he'd spent his entire life around it. But that's a true story, yeah. Hatters used to go crazy because of the mercury. Yeah. And they weren't able to get Apple TV.
Would you like to travel in the past or in the future? Or what would you change?
Probably all right, not traveling in time. it's not anything I really want to do again, I think. But yeah, I think it's, you know, I like what the film says about time, which is that, you know, it's very much about kind of accepting what's happened and that kind of freeing you to live a bit more comfortably in the present. And but yeah, if I did travel, I'd probably like do something really boring, like just, I would probably want to be like 1 year old and have someone like look after me and, you know, be in a pram or something.
Well, I can do that.
Yeah,
I'm free.
Okay. All right, I'll probably up to that.
Thank you.
You don't need to time travel.
Thank you.
If you could choose three people, dead or alive, to invite to a Mad Hatter's tea party, who would be there and why?
Well, if they're dead, it'd be no fun, would it? I mean, not
time alive. Travel, you could bring them back first, then, yeah.
English speaking or non-English speaking, because that's also a big thing.
I don't know.
I don't know. Three's hard. I don't know. Oscar Wilde?
Yeah.
He's quite a good one. Charles Dickens?
Yeah.
Also very good.
It's quite a highbrow.
Yeah, no, it's very highbrow. Yeah. Okay, slightly more low. And Charlie Chaplin.
Nice.
There you go. There you go.
I would choose Patti Smith and nice. Mary Shelley and Amy Winehouse.
No, very nice. Good. Amy Winehouse. I remember going to see Tim in Vancouver to talk about making the movie, and he gave me a warning saying how hard it was. And did I listen? No, I'm still here today. But his amazing advice initially was don't shoot on green because it sends you completely crazy. So I didn't do that. I shot on blue. That was incredibly helpful. and then from that day onwards, he created such a beautiful world in the first movie. I felt very much like to create this one within the parameters of that world. So, you know, in terms of like character design and location design, it was very helpful. And then, of course, script stuff. And then, actually, obviously, Tim lives in London, so he shot here in London too, which was very helpful, so he was around for that. So it was incredibly helpful for me, because it's like, you know, it's his world, so I was just very pleased to be able to have drawn his experience of it.
But really important as well for you to make it your world as well.
Yeah, no, for sure, no, because obviously I felt that this film is set in a different time period, and it's set in different geographical locations, so there's a certain different feel like it brings to a degree, but I felt it had to stay within the same universe, you know, in terms of course, the characters pre-existed, and I felt that the, you know, Sasha's character had to very much fit in the kind of, you know, paint box of those people. Mm. And so that's why we went with a sort of, his, I always think about silhouettes in character design. His silhouettes are very striking, gigantic shoulder pads. You know, and it's like, for me, it's like he designed it, because he's a show-off. And so therefore he'd want to impress people.
My,
you know,
character.
So his character, not so. No, so it just felt like he very much fitted into that world, you know, so that was kind of good. And these guys like talking, you may have noticed, especially together. And there's a whole, if you delve into the depths of the DVD extras, you'll find moments of the two of them just making the noise at each other for about 5 minutes. Which is
I think we did do one improv take during that lasted so long, and the studio was so hot.
Yeah,
because
it's
blue screen, so it's just lights. Filled with lights. I think the camera melted.
Yeah, basically the camera broke down.
That's
yeah,
how long the improv take was.
But before, which was probably about half an hour or something.
Yeah, yeah, it was a long time.
It was probably about 30 minutes of James just let Sasha and I...
It's the hard R-rated version of Alice in Wonderland.
Exactly.
And so peripherally, as you're about kind of 15 minutes into this giant improv, and you don't see anywhere that it's going to stop. Peripherally, I just saw crew members walking off to lunch.
Oh, it's a good sign.
Thinking, we probably have to end this.
The light's going off. Just
but we didn't. Yeah. It was too much fun.
Yeah.
You've touched a little bit on how you had to explore different sides of the Mad Hatter character. How was it playing a slightly less mad version for this time? There's a scene where Alice says that she makes no sense compared to you. How was it, as in preparation for the character, different from the previous one? And also, how do you think this 5-6 years since the last film has, the time has actually been on your side?
The time has been on my side.
Yeah.
How?
Because
I'm still alive.
Yes. That's very good to know.
It's plus.
Which I know is a miracle, but.
I am on his side. Yeah.
Oh, so he's on my
side.
He's on
your side. Literally on your side.
Literally.
Here we go, it's improv time.
Was it nice to explore a bit more depth to the character, I guess?
See, that's the thing. What was really interesting about playing the Hatter this time, in the first film with Tim, the Mad Hatter, it's the Mad Hatter, so there's pretty much a good deal of license that you can take and interesting places that you could travel, within that. The context of the character, the Mad Hatter. But when you're dealing with the Mad Hatter who has gone noticeably farther down that road of insanity, it's like that thing, it's like the, if you are crazy, if you do have some sort of mental, some sort of dilemma in the brain. If you're not aware of it, it's great, If you're aware that you're crazy, it'll eat you alive. So I think in this Hatter, he there's so many things that he has to question. And he has to travel in so many different spots. So basically, it's taking the Mad Hatter and making him infinitely more mad, more confused, more lost, more paranoid, more even violent. So that was a great challenge.
Yeah. When we talked about it initially, it was the idea of what is madness to a mad person.
Yeah.
And it kind of almost draws towards sanity. So you're wearing a suit, you have smart hair, and you're quite cogent at points, but there's always an element of madness about it too, so that's kind of an interesting idea, I thought.
You're walking down the street and you see a boy, a six-year-old boy, that happens to be yourself, he doesn't know, and you had
Is this about to get weird?
No. Maybe, I don't know. But you had a chance to give him three advices. And maybe changing his future, your own past, and changing your future. What advices could you give him regarding your artistic career, your personal life? I don't know, but...
First thing I would say is search for simplicity. Stay away from anything that makes a bunch of people stare at you while you're in a restaurant.
Okay.
or makes them follow you in cars and motorcycles back to your hotel, or try to avoid people who write incredibly, sometimes entertaining, but incredibly ludicrous fiction about you and your family. So those are a couple of things I would avoid. I'd probably also say, if anybody gives you any shit, just beat the fuck out of them.
It was like when you open the script, presented with such an immediate scene where Alice is like being a female action hero, but not like a conventionally masculine one, and what it was what it was like to see her being so fearless. Did that excite you?
I thought they'd accidentally given me Alice of the Caribbean or something. but no, it was really cool to be given a something that was very active, and she comes from a place where she's been a captain of a ship for 2 years and feeling incredibly empowered and doing what she loves, and so it was it was really fun. It was
except
the shooting it, which was in the last 3 days and three nights of being wet and freezing in the
clubs. Mia was blue on set. She has blue.
Yeah, blue lips.
It's properly
quite a trooper always.
Properly
yes.
cold.
So she's a trooper because she's also wet and cold. Yeah. She's massively unappealing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, aren't you guys impressed when you watch the movie at everything that she pulls off? It's pretty incredible.
Was it a tank? Were you filming in a tank?
I mean, it was a gimbal we built out in Longcross, so not in sea. We had these enormous 2-ton tanks, water splashing everywhere, and it was 3 in the morning and freezing in November.
Wow.
So Mia was very brave to
miss that one. Yeah.
You'd have made the water warm.
Yeah. No, too expensive. Forget it. Sorry.
Do you both believe that there's an accurate and fair representation of LGBT characters in Disney movies today to teach the next generation about the ever-changing world that we all live in?
That's a jolly good question. I think so. I mean, it's hard. It's something everyone's very aware of these days. And whenever you make anything, it's something you always, because it's part of the world you live in. And I think when you make a film these days, you can't help but put that into it anyway. And so, you know, people always say to me, "How do you update Lewis Carroll?" You say, I just do what I think is interesting and important. I think so. It's one of the things that I think people are always very aware of, I think, I'm pretty sure.
I hate label. I mean, I know we're at a time when, you know, things, I'm just the type of person that's I wish we weren't in a world where, you know, why don't women get paid as much as men? It's stupid. I mean, none of these things, are there enough gay, lesbian character? But that we have to label it shows how bad things really are. So, I mean, I'm not really one for trying to be politically correct or do this or that, but I do think that, you know, it's just unfortunate that we even have to talk about it, and then how do you deal with it? I don't know. It's unfortunate, but, I don't know what that is anyway, because I don't know what's, like, you know. I guess I'm confused. I don't know whether I'm gay or straight, or half of my friends are, or if they're men or women. So I'm way behind.
I'm gay and I'm a woman.
And on that note, ladies and gentlemen,
I would like to. I'm going to do this everywhere I go. I would really like to apologize for not smuggling my dogs. into England, because it would have been a bad thing to do. Because the Australians, though chipper, and kind of, they're chipper and they're.
That's funny. I feel like Johnny's dogs were here, weren't they? Weren't they with you on set?
I forgot to tell you they're dead. I just sat on them.
The dogs.
Okay, I tried to kill them after Australia.
ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your time and your questions. Please, can you give a round of applause to our wonderful
cast
today? Thank you.